Good evening. Welcome to Wednesday Church. And for those who, at 6 o'clock, by the way, Wednesday Church at 6 o'clock. We'll see how that works. It was suggested by some people to the council, and all the reasons seemed logical and made sense, so we thought we'd give it a try for a while. We don't know that it's permanent, but we're going to, we put the sign up there, so on the window, so it says 6 o'clock. We would have to take a zero off and put a 3 back if we were going to move back, but we're going to try 6 o'clock for a while. That said, we want to welcome all of you who are watching online. We'd love to see you here as well. Please follow the worship words and song lyrics as they appear on your device, and you get to do the same. We're going to do announcements right now and take our offering at this time. And so while that's happening, I'm going to run through some announcements. We invite those of you who are watching online to give. You can do that electronically by pressing the green button on the weekly update that's sent to you, or you can go to our website and hit give, and there's a drop-down menu. You know, to give, when we give for a purpose. We don't, this is kind of a historical thing. People have been giving since the beginning of the church, since the beginning of faith, when the first faithful wandered the desert. Every now and then they would stop and gather and take some rocks and stones and build an altar, and they would offer oil and wheat and maybe a calf. And they did it because they felt they were called to do it. We still do that. Does it pay the electric bill? Sure. Does it take care of our internet charges? Sure. But that's not the reason we give. We give because it's a mark of our discipleship. So we invite you to do that and you to do the same. So that said, there's a quilting bee. If you've never done this, we invite you to come and be a part of it. There are some faithful people who get together regularly and put together quilts, so they just need to be tied, which means that you're going to take a string and you kind of weave it through and then just cut it and tie knots. It's pretty simple. If I can do it, you can do it. And it's a good time of fellowship. And Landon dug up this picture of a young Billy Houck. He's got no gray hair. Look at that, man. Yeah. How about that? That's on July 16th. We're excited about this. It's a Polka Sunday, July 30th. That also happens to be the day that our young people are going to be doing an appreciation brunch. So come, and we're going to have an extended band for this Polka service at 9:15 on the 30th. I've been getting pushed quite a while to do this, so I gave in. Actually, I didn't even give in. I was just told we're going to have a polka service on the 30th. Anyway, we put out flyers in the community because apparently that's a thing. There's some small card invitations on the information desk out here. So if you want to invite someone, pick one of those up and take it to them and just give it to them and let them know that you'd love them to come to our polka service. Again, there will be a thank you brunch from our youth. All of you have done a lot to support our young people this past year, and they want to just show their appreciation and say thank you and show you some of the things that they've done and are doing. So please come to that. That'll be following worship, following the polka service, and you'll be so hungry after dancing polka, you'll want a bite to eat. So come to that. That's on the 30th. Also, on the 30th, you can also give some blood. There's a lot going on the 30th, isn't there? So if you haven't signed up already, there's a sign-up sheet out here on the information desk, or you can go to giveblood.org, look for Christ Lutheran in the right-hand side. And listen, I was talking to somebody not too long ago, and they said, you know, I don't give here because I give what they call double cells. And they do that on the bus. They do that on the blood thing. So I give double cells. So if you want to do that, please sign up and do that. We're trying to get to 20, 25 people to show up for that every time they come. So please be a part of that. That's also on the 30th from 9 to 1:15. This is also a thing. This is directory time. We haven't done a directory in a long, long time. And so what happens if you've never been through this before is you get your picture taken. So you have to set up a time. Someone will call you and set up a time unless you want to sign up right after worship today. You can set up a time. We want you or your family or whoever, your significant other, whoever you spend your time with and identify with, to sign up. We need about 75 family groups to sign up in order to make this thing okay. What will happen is they'll take your picture. You get a free picture. That's what you get. They're also going to invite you to maybe explore purchasing more pictures for your family. For some of you, that might be the time to do it. For some of you, it might not be the time to do it. That's entirely up to you. There's no pressure. You're just invited to do that. We really need 75 pictures, I guess, family units, whatever you want to say. So please do that. If nothing else, just come and get your picture taken, all right? Thanks. There's a list out on the information desk. Lutheran World Relief is one of the largest relief, faith-based relief organizations in the world. It's part of our church. And so there's a supply list every summer through August of things that we put in a backpack that gets sent all over the world. So take a look at that. Take one with you. We invite you to pick up extra pencils and paper and things of whatever's on that list. We don't need the backpacks. We just need the people to do this. All right. Anybody got a birthday today? Today? Somebody told me they had a birthday and they were going to come today, and I don't see them here, so I guess they lose out. I do have a special thing. You can just go to another slide at whatever's blank. Thanks. In a congregation, especially one that's, I think maybe I shared last time that I was a mission developer or a church planner. And so what you learn is not everybody that's a member is a member. You know, we don't put so much emphasis anymore on you got to sign and give your fingerprint and all the rest of that stuff. Instead, people who come regularly are members. And so we kind of have, we have a daughter of the congregation, I think I'm going to call her, an adopted daughter of our congregation. Her name is Cheyenne Rogers. She goes by Shay. You may know Shay. Shay, come up here. I'm going to make you come up here. When are you leaving?
Tuesday.
Shay leaves Tuesday to join the United States Navy. And so we invite you to maybe make a gesture of blessing. Put your hand up like this, and we're going to offer a prayer for you, all right? Let's pray. Oh, loving God, you give us so much, and we appreciate so dearly the freedoms that we enjoy in a nation. Almighty and eternal God, those who take refuge in you will be glad and forever will shout for joy. We ask you to protect our sister Shay as she goes off to basic training at Great Lakes Naval Station. Protect her with the shield of your strength and keep her safe from all evil and harm. May the power of your love enable her to return home in safety, that with all who love her, that we may praise you and give thanks for your loving care. We just ask these things in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thanks, Shay. Okay, you may have noticed that Kara is not here this evening, so we took that time to... When I started a church, I didn't have a band, so I used videos a lot. And so we're just going to take some time right now. I don't know what your day was like. I don't need to get into the details of my day. It was strange and hectic and emotional and all kinds of things. And so to prepare our hearts and minds for worship, we're just going to take some time to settle in, to find some peace, and to be still.
I will be still, no.
still and know you are God.
You are peace to a restless soul. Yeah, you are peace where my thoughts wage war. You are peace to the anxious heart. And that's who you are. That's who you are.
Yeah, you are peace where my feet takes hold. Yeah, you are peace when I feel enclosed. Oh, you are peace when I lose control. That's who you are. That's who you
everything first comes from you. And so these gifts have been given as a sign of our love and devotion, that you might use them and us to grow your kingdom in this place. Amen. We join our voices together and we confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed, saying, I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We gather this evening in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated. If you would pray with me, please. O God of the covenant, you call ministers to proclaim your gospel of grace. Inspire pastors and deacons and church musicians and all lay people who you call ministers of your word to carry out their work in your name. O God of all creation, you reveal your goodness through all that you have made. The rivers and the seas and the animals. Encourage and bless those who work to advocate and care for all of creation. O God of the nations, you desire that all people of the world live in peace. Guide government leaders throughout the world to work for justice, for mercy, for reconciliation. We pray for our president and all elected leaders, for those who respond to our crisis, fight our fires, keep us safe, and those who work for peace. O God of compassion, you bring your healing to those who are sick and consolation to those who are grieving. Provide those in need with the care that they need. Make your presence known among all who suffer in mind, body, and spirit. O God, you know our concerns before we speak them, and yet we offer them at this time silently or loud. O God of rejoicing, you have brought us together to worship around word and sacrament. Give us patience to wait on you as we make our way through the changes and chances of this life, and give us faith to trust your promises, your promise of new life, a full and abundant life. God of faithfulness, through the witness of those who have gone before us, instill in us the desire to be your church in this place. Show us where you would have us go and what you would have us do. Into your hands, O God, we commend all for whom we pray. In the name of the one who reconciled all creation to himself, Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. And all of God's people said, Amen. So last week, my alarm went off to remind me that worship starts in 10 minutes. Anyway, if you were with us last week, you might remember that we began a look at the book of Acts. Acts is the fifth book of the New Testament, and we learned that this book is actually one of two parts that are written by an apostle named Luke, who is the author of the third gospel, which bears his name. Now, if you remember, we heard that after Jesus had been resurrected, he appeared to the disciples and many other people. And he was with them for about 40 days, and he told them then to wait in Jerusalem for the promise of God and God's Holy Spirit to come upon them, that they would be baptized, not with water, but with the Holy Spirit. And so we spent some time last week talking about how difficult it is to wait for God. Actually, how difficult it is to wait for just about anything these days. I could press a button on my phone and, well, I did yesterday, or the day before yesterday, I pressed a button on my own phone and ordered my Nespresso coffee, and it was here today, you know? And so it's difficult to wait, and so we considered that. Today, we're still in the book of Acts. We will be for a while, but today we find Jesus leaving his disciples. Now, one of the things that I've shared in the past is a way to think about how God works in our lives. And to do that, I kind of swiped a line from a song in the mid-90s. It's a phrase. You've heard me say it. God comes down. God comes down in love, and that love has a name, and that name is Jesus. Right? You've heard me say that. So an easy way to think of Jesus is God's love coming to us in the person of Jesus, who embodied the Christ, who is the Christ. And that through his birth and his life and his teachings and his death and resurrection, and whenever we witness a love that is different than the love the world wants us to know, it is in those moments that we witness and know God's love for us and for the world. And that the way we mostly demonstrate our love for God is by loving others. And this way, God shows us his love for us. And actually, Jesus shows us how to love or what love is like when he was raised up on the cross. And in doing so, we believe that we were made free from sin and death and self-centeredness, and that through faith, a faith that always draws us back to God. But now in the book of Acts, we hear an account of Jesus doing kind of the opposite of coming down. Now he's leaving his disciples by going up. This witness in the scriptures is known as the ascension. We hear about it twice from the author Luke, once in the Gospel of Luke and once here in Acts. There are some other places where the Apostle Paul mentions it, but it's actually here as the actual account in Acts. And this is from a version of the Bible called The Message. After his death, he presented himself alive to them in many different settings over a period of 40 days. In face-to-face meetings, he talked to them about the things concerning the kingdom of God. As they met and ate meals together, he told them that they were on no account to leave Jerusalem, but must wait for what the Father promised. The promise you heard from me, John baptized with water, but you will be baptized in the Holy Spirit and soon. When they were together for the last time, they asked, Master, are you going to restore the kingdom of Israel now? To Israel now? Is this the time? And this is a reference to the disciples who still haven't quite figured out what's going to happen. They're still kind of waiting for Jesus to restore Israel, the kingdom to Israel, and to expel the oppressors, the Roman occupiers, as well as to confront and try to repair the corrupt church or church leaders at that time who used their power to kind of keep them under thumb. So they're waiting for this to happen, and they think that Jesus is going to do it. They just don't know the whole story quite yet. He told them, that is Jesus, you don't get to know the time. Timing is the Father's business. What you get is the Holy Spirit. And when the Holy Spirit comes on you, you will be able to be my witnesses in Jerusalem, all over Judea and Samaria, even to the ends of the world. These were his last words. As they watched, he was taken up and disappeared in a cloud. They stood there, staring up at the empty sky. Suddenly, two men appeared in white robes. They said, "You Galileans, why do you just stand here looking up at an empty sky? This very Jesus who was taken up from among you to heaven will come as certainly and mysteriously as he left." This is the word of the Lord. Now, before I get too far into this thing, I think it's important to know that for those who struggle with the Jesus story, or those who struggle with religion or even the Bible, one of the questions or even arguments that you'll often hear is this: really? Jesus floated up in the sky? Really? Now, I've talked to you about this before, but I wanted to emphasize that this is not what this account is about. It's just not. And like a few things in the scriptures, when we hear something supernatural happening, we tend to get hung up on the how of the account instead of the why of the account. So I just want to address this for a moment. Did Jesus float up into the sky? Well, you just heard it right from the scriptures. That's what the scripture says. And so it's a matter of faith, right? Did Jesus walk on water? Did he heal the sick? Did he raise the dead? Well, that's what the scriptures say. So it's the same deal. It's a matter of faith. And if you're not there yet, that's okay. You know, when we read this, it seems, when you read this, you kind of get this picture of Jesus kind of hopping around on the clouds somewhere, right? And in its telling and writing in the first century then, most people believed in what we call a three-tiered view of the universe. We've talked about this before, where good exists up there and we kind of exist here and everything bad exists down there, right? But we don't believe that any longer. We don't believe that any longer. So does that mean that what we just read is a bunch of hooey? Of course not. The Israelites, in the first century, at that time, believed in a three-tiered view of the universe. They didn't understand anything about outer space or the planets or the solar system as we do. I mean, they thought the world was flat and that the sky or the heavens were actually bound by a firmament, kind of a dome. It was a place, like the earth is a place, and that there was an opening, and that opening was above Jerusalem, and that's how you accessed heaven. You know, as in any writing, there's a context which is in which it is written, and there's a context in which we read it today. Are you with me? For instance, maybe you've heard this before. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, but they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, and among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. I'm guessing that you might have heard that before. It's from our Declaration of Independence that we just remembered a couple of weeks ago or a week ago. The thing is that when that was written, those who wrote it really didn't believe that all men were created equal, or that they were endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights. They just didn't. But we do, because we have a different understanding than they did then. Are you with me? So if this account in Acts is just about Jesus floating up into to the clouds, well, then it might be an issue. But that's not what it's about. And by the way, if you're wondering, for me, I tend to think of Jesus passing through a veil that separates the earthly from the divine, what we know and what we can see and touch and what we can't. Some might call these dimensions, some might call these something else. Anyway, regardless of how you get there, the point isn't the how in this case. It's the why in this case. It's the why. That's the real question of the ascension. Why did Jesus have to leave? I mean, this is one of those questions that I needed to confront as a kind of a re-minted believer when I came back to faith and returned to the church as an adult, is why? I mean, our faith, our religion is based on a belief of a man who died 2,000 years ago but didn't stay dead. He rose from the tomb and opened us for us a way to a different life, a new life, a life that God intended for us to live. And listen, fundamental to our belief in the Jesus message and movement is that God created us to live a different life, what we call a fully human life. And if that's true, then it begs the question, why? Why did Jesus have to leave? I mean, wouldn't it have been better if he just kind of stuck around? I mean, it would have made things maybe a little easier if there, you know, if there was a 2,000-year-old Jesus living in Jerusalem. Maybe we'd have an office there to consult when things get hard, or to correct us as a world when things go awry and we get out of whack. Why didn't Jesus just stick around? It certainly would have been more convenient, right? But apparently God doesn't do things strictly for our convenience. And what's convenient, quite honestly, is not always best for us. In fact, I'm sure that that's not true most of the time. You know? What God desires from us is good. What God desires from us is to choose to love Him back in the way that He loves us. And so in God's wisdom, it was good for Jesus to leave. But listen, it's still okay for us to ask, why? I mean, this is how we learn about the things of God, especially in our tradition. We ask the question, why? So one way I was thinking about this, and I think one way to ask this question or to think of this question might be to ask, why did you leave your parents' home when you were old enough? Why didn't you just stay at home so that your parents could make sure that you didn't go out on your own and make your own choices, choices which sometimes didn't go so well, right? Well, the answer is that wouldn't be freedom. It wouldn't be freedom. And because being made in God's image means that we get the freedom to choose for ourselves. And that's how God made us to be. So why did Jesus have to leave? Well, first of all, he actually tells us. In the Gospel of John, he says, "But in fact, it is best for you that I go away, because if I don't, the Advocate, or the Holy Spirit, won't come. And if I do go away, then I will send him to you." Jesus ascends to wherever Jesus ascends. And if we believe him, he returns in the Spirit on the day of Pentecost. So Jesus no longer is just this one man. Now Jesus is in each of us. The Christ is in each of us by God's Spirit. He comes and enters into the people who make his church present and known, and the church becomes his body, his presence in the world, to keep us united with one another and with God. And in him, you in him and him in you, just like he prayed, that the world would know him through you, that the world would know him through you. And that's it. It's not that complicated. But it doesn't mean that we're supposed to just sit on our pews and do nothing and wait for God to do the work. You see, faith is not like a bag of M&Ms, something that we can just reach for when we want something sweet. Faith is a lifestyle. It's a way of life. Faith is when we're willing to put God first and live that love by loving others. When we do this, we find that we have meaning and purpose to our life, more than we can ever find in the things that the world tells us is important. What we discover in this life through faith in him, and not just in him who was taken up in the sky, but in him who came in the Spirit to dwell in you and in me, what we find through faith in him is what Jesus calls and promises a full and abundant life. We find an abundant life by doing God's will. And listen, that can mean many different things for each of us. What is God's will for you and me? Well, I suppose that it depends. God gives each of us different gifts, and we are called to use those gifts to God's glory, to be Christ's body for the world, to be his church in all the ways that we are the church. From an institution in which people of faith gather for worship and inspiration, where they find refuge and respite from the world, a church that reaches out as commanded to care for the widow and the orphan and the stranger, to feed the hungry and clothe the naked, and to sit with the prisoner, to love as he loves us, and to be his church individually, using the gifts that we've been given to make his kingdom true. Did that make sense? So don't sit around trying to figure out the how of the ascension. Nor are you to stand there looking up with your mouth hanging open like codfish, wondering what might come that's better. Instead, we are to live out the why of the ascension. Because listen, brothers and sisters, God needs you now. The world really needs the hope that his kingdom reveals. I mean, we can all use some hope, right? And that hope is a vision of a world in which all people turn towards God through faith. And by the power of God's Spirit in you, God will make all things new. Even you. Amen. May the peace of God, which passes all our understanding, keep our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. That makes sense? Thanks. You thought you were going to get out of singing tonight, probably, but that's not the case. Can you start? I don't know how that start there, man. Can we start over again? Started like that, man. You can stand up if you're able. Let's try this again. I may have opened my mouth too soon. Oh, there we go. You may be seated, except those of you going to Leadership Lab. Come up here. You've heard about Leadership Lab in the past. Leadership Lab is started out back in the 60s, are you going to leadership land?
Someone to leave me.
Oh, okay. Back in the 60s, you want to go that way a little bit because you got enough of them going. Back in the 60s, three synods in Illinois put together a way to train leaders for the church. And you think, well, what's that mean? Well, we need leaders in the church. We always need leaders of the church, whether the lay people in congregations or whether they find themselves a call along the way and feel to be do public ministry, whatever that might be for them. Anyway, it's important for us to train leaders in the church, and I'll tell you why. Some of you may have heard that Ken Weiss, who was a youth leader here for a long time and the pastor at Ebenezer Lutheran and Emmanuel Lutheran in Berlin and Wiedeville, respectively. Did I get that right? Yeah. And he's retiring at the end of the month. These are really rural churches. Also, there's a young pastor by the name of Evan Cameron, who's the pastor at the church, I think it's St. Peter's in Phillipsburg and St. John?
James
at New Adam. He and his wife and two children are moving back home to Ohio. I also think that Zionsville is still seeking a pastor. And I think there's an interim at Rayburg. So there was a time I was having dinner the other night with the assistant to the bishop who's in charge of finding pastors. And she told me that at one time when she first took the job, there was usually a list of 2,600 pastors. I'm not suggesting you guys all got to be pastors, but I'm just saying there used to be a list of 2,600 pastors that were going on and off the roster who were available for call, you know, at any given time about that law. She told me that today that number is 450. We need leaders in the church. I don't know what the church is going to look like in the future, but clearly, even in the time that I've been a part of the church in my lifetime, it's changed, and it's going to continue to change. But listen, in the end, God wins. So it doesn't mean the church is going away. It means it's going to change. And you got to be a part of that change. And these young people are going to be lifted up and trained as leaders in the church in their own unique way with their own unique gifts. So Leadership Lab is at Augustana College in Rock Island, Illinois, part of the Quad Cities. I took part in Leadership Lab as a staff member. I didn't really want to go. I got talked into going, and I went as a leader, and it was remarkable. And it has changed itself over time. But these young people, is there any more? One is not here tonight, so we have a total of 9 young people going to Leadership Lab. And so we want to pray for them on their journey, especially for the time that they have there, that it be most fruitful, and that they make it safely home again, filled with enthusiasm and spirit for the church. Please pray with me. I invite you again to make a gesture of blessing if you wish. Oh, gracious God, we just ask that you watch over these young people and Sharon, who's also going as an adult leader. We just ask that you watch over them in their travels towards Leadership Lab, that it be safe, that it be productive and fun, and that they don't have too many issues along the way. We ask for that you be with them during this week, that you fill them with the Spirit. Remove from them any of their inhibitions about who they are in their own mind, and let them give themselves over to the process, to this lab, this experience that's going to happen. Help them build new and healthy relationships that will last, not only with one another, but with you. We ask you to bring them home safely, without issues, and once again to be a part of your church here and wherever you might send them. We ask these things in Jesus' name. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Have a blast, man. And not only that, I think it's about 30 degrees cooler there than it is here. So enjoy that. Here they go. Thank you. You're leaving on Sunday, right?
Yes.
Leave on Sunday. All right. As you're able, please stand, and we're going to get on with this. The scriptures tell us that if we believe we are without sin, we're lying to ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sin, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So we join our voices together and confess our sins, saying, Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake God forgives us all our sin. As a called and ordained minister in the Church of Jesus Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all of your sin in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. We take a time to greet each other with signs of peace and then gather for the dinner. Peace. We just have you gather around the table here. We were talking about the things that we read from the scriptures and that need faith for us to believe. And this not only is one of those things, this is something that Jesus told us to do. He told us to take these common things, bread and wine, as he gathered around the table with his disciples. And then he said, This is my body given for you. Take and eat. Do this in remembrance of me. And then again after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, Take and drink, all of you. This cup is the new covenant, the new relationship in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. Please pray with me. O God, pour out your Holy Spirit on your people gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine, these common things, and yet through faith in you, your true presence in us. By your Spirit, make us one body in Christ, one in mission and ministry to the world. Nourish us in faith and hope and love, and strengthen us for service until we feast with you in glory. All praise and honor and glory are yours, Holy Triune God, now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. These are the gifts of God given for you, the people of God, and all are invited. Thanks be to God.
Yeah. your brother bring it down.
There we go. I picked those two songs, and I love them. This one's like 7 minutes long, and we've kept you for a while tonight because we do lots of extra things. So, I'm just going to say the Lord, the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Please pray with me. Oh God, come to us. By your Spirit, come to us and live in us through these gifts of bread and wine, your true presence in us. Use us as we go from this place to proclaim the good news that the kingdom is near. In Jesus' name, amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and grant you his peace. Amen. This is the best I could do. Not a bad ditty. That's all I got. Go ahead and play it.